I'm making this video to explain how I managed to get my 1 horsepower sewing machine servo motor working with my mini lathe, because some of you wanted to know this because they have the same lathe and they wanted to do it as well. And as you can see, everything still fits on of the original parts, everything works, still works, and the most important thing for me was to be able to convert it back. If I ever wanted to use the original parts, if I want to sell my mini lathe, I can put the old motor back on the lathe and it still will work as it was working before. Now I'm going to take this cover off. Which will reveal the 2 pulleys I used from the motor to the headstock. And there you can see the belt. It's a HTT 5M belt. And it has a length of 350 mm and a width of 9 mm. I first tried a 375 mm length and a 50 mm belt width, but the belt was that did not fit either with the width or the length. So I then bought a 330 mm length belt, but it was too short, so I had to go with the middle with 350 mm. But this worked then really well, and now I will show you on the motor. Here you can see the motor pulley, and it is a 14 tooth HTT5 pulley, and with the motor shaft being a 15 mm outer diameter shaft, there was no way of fitting the stock keyway from the motor with this pulley, because there are only 1 or 2 millimeters left between the shaft and the pulley, so it's not possible to put the keyway into the pulley. But I used the compression from the nut to make it a compression fit. And if this still doesn't work, I will use some green Loctite, and with that it will be a really, really tight fit if it doesn't work like that. But if you do it like that, the compression fit will act as a sort of overload protection, because if something gets jammed in the lathe, it will spin at the motor and nothing really would get hurt or damaged. Now here we have the headstock pulley, and as you can see, I had to machine this as well to make it fit the stock shaft, and on this one I were able to put a keyway into it with a file and some muscle power, and this worked well for me. And you can see that I had to make it a little bit recessed, because the old one was a little bit narrower, and to make the new pulley fit well with the new belt, I had to make it a little bit wider than the old one, and therefore this recess had to be cut. Now onto the controller. I mounted the controller with some wood I had laying around on a little bit of an angle, so I can see the display really good when I'm working, and also I put the switch right on top of that and not on the front of the lathe like it used to be, because you can really easily trigger this by just pushing with your hand against, and then no matter what there is in, if you have left the chuck key in the chuck, and it will start spinning and it will damage something. So I put the switch right on top of them, and in addition I put this rope on this as a sort of emergency stop, because whenever I pull on that rope, it pulls Now it's broken again. my light was just a little bit flickering, and now let's continue. If I ever had an emergency and I had to stop the lathe, I just have to hit this with my hand to make the lathe stop. Now on to how I mounted the motor. There were already 4 holes on each side on the motor, but with an M4 thread, and I enlarged that to M5 because it was were an easy task for me, because I have a drill press which fits the motor pretty good, and I made an angle of scrap material I had laying around, and this is a 3 millimeter thick material, and it is adjustable to tighten the belt. And this mount is really a sturdy piece. I wasn't sure if this will be tough enough for this to get the belt tension right, but yeah, it's pretty sturdy. And now I wanted to show you how I ground my chuck jaws, because I had a very high run out of about 0.5 millimeter, and now I were able to reduce it to 0.03 millimeters, which is pretty good for this mini lathe. And when you want to grind your jaws, every jaw has some sort of play in it, and if you just grind them like, if they're like this, you won't get the run out to a low number, because I think it also will get worse if you grind them like this. So you have to load them, and I did it with 3 of those square pieces of steel I cut with my angle grinder, and you have to put in every slot 1 of this piece, and then you can clamp it down, and this will preload the chucks, and you have to put them very on the outside so that you still can. It's a bit tricky to put them in. There are special tools for industrial lathes that preload the chuck jaws, but on this small chuck there isn't a tool, because these tools, they have the industrial chucks which have to be ground, they have 3 holes in them where you can fit the tool that preloads the chuck jaws. But this works as well to preload. And now you can see I have successfully preloaded the chuck jaws so that they have no more slop in them. And then you can use your Dremel tool or your Proxen tool, they're both the same. And there you can see my Dremel tool. I made a little tool holder for it to fit my homemade quick change tool holder. I made that in my school time when I were at the technical higher school. And then you set the feed rate of the lathe to its lowest setting so that it can feed by itself a constant feed, and you set the Dremel tool to its max speed setting and let the lathe do its work. Only take a few thousands each pass and you will get a really, really good run out. And here you can see, if I switch it on, like that, it will feed the, I won't take any material now because I already ground the jaws of my truck, so I don't need to grind them another time. Another more time. And like that, you can grind your truck jaws to get a better run out. And it worked for me. Really good, really good, I can say. Yeah, I hope you now know how to upgrade your lathe with the 1 horsepower sewing machine motor and grind your chuck chores. And by the way, I also upgraded my spindle bearings on this lathe. These are the original bearings. These are just ordinary ball bearings you will find everywhere, and these are very cheap and really not designed to take any axial loads. Then I switched to tapered roller bearings, and they are really strong and they have a really high surface area to run on. They are much stronger than the cheap ball bearings, but they have a higher resistance and need a specific amount of preload. And with the preload set to the right amount, these bearings produce a very high resistance. And I had a watt meter hooked to my lathe, and it with no load onto the lathe, it already read 300 watts of power, which only consumed by these bearings. And then I removed the tapered roller bearings and put in angular contact bearings. They are similar to the standard ball bearings, but they have one side bigger than the other. That means that they can also take axial loads. And the big advantage of the angular contact bearings is that they, as you can see, the standard ball bearings, they have a seal, so no dirt or chips from your cuttings will get into them. As you can see on the tapered roller bearings, they don't have such seals, so dirt and debris and chips can easily get into them, and the lifespan will suffer from that. And also you have to loop them with grease, because in the headstock you have no way to seal that properly up to make it oil, to hold oil and not leak oil. So you have to go with grease, and you would have to grease them very often to keep them from running dry, because the worst thing to happen to a bearing is to run dry. And yeah, so I installed the angular contact bearings. They also need a preload to achieve a high surface finish, but they have way less friction and produce less resistance for the motor, and they are running smoother for my feeling. And they are sealed, so, and no dirt can get into them. And also they are lubricated for their whole life span, so you never have to open the lathe up and loop them. So I hope you enjoyed this little video of me showing how I made my lathe work really good for me. Now I can take almost a 4 millimeter depth of cut, which would never be possible with the motor and bearings I used before. And I have to apologize for my bad English, but I still have to learn so much of how to pronounce or spell or to name such specific things like the headstock or the spindle bearings. I also always have to think of what I want to say, but in the meantime, I will still use my lathe and have fun with it now that it works like a charm. And I wish you a good day, and bye.